Hey guys, today I decided to read some negative reviews of my favorite books. I'll mix the opinions found in scholarly articles with the ones from Goodreads, so this should be fun. And to make this even more interesting, I'll tell you the title only after I read the reviews. So let's see if you're good detectives. The first one is actually my favorite book of all time. I'm not afraid to say this. I kind of divide novels into two categories. This one and everything else. I love it so much. And I wonder if I'll get defensive or not. Let's see. Depressing and masochistic. Though on the other hand, if you like being beaten with 50-page allegories about the depravity of mankind, well, by all means, be my guest. This person has a point. Yeah, I guess it can be depressing, and I do like allegories about the depravity of mankind. Yeah, that's true. Warning, Sisyphean task ahead, guaranteed to induce 50 exasperated sighs per page. Why would you do this to yourself? Why would you force yourself to read something so annoying? I can't think of any reason. Next one, if you like reading silly love stories, then this is the book for you. Yeah, silly love story. This is the best description. You laugh when you see the title. If ever there were a case of literary emperor's clothes, this is it. Great. This is not a work of genius. It is verily poorly constructed, far too long, tortured, and a superficial rant. It is not a novel, more a treatise raising some important philosophical issues, but not really in any depth nor anything much of value. The only chapter I remembered enjoying was the last one, which was well written as well as having the merit of being the last one. Well, we agree. The last chapter is actually great. Oh, this one seems to be the perfect response to the previous one. Talk about anticlimactic. This book has one of the lamest endings I've ever come across. For the first several hundred pages, author goes overboard on the character development. He continues to develop the character for far too long, then once he's run out of possible ways to develop them any further, he finally says, "The hell with this, I'm writing a murder mystery." This sounds interesting. Then we have several hundred pages of who done it, why done it, etc. Then finally he says, "This book is long enough," and just ends the damn thing. I don't think he's ever had this moment that this book is long enough. I don't know. These characters are such high school drama. They're storming with jealousy, bitter, angry, infatuated, obsessed, crying, fainting, lying, murdering, stealing, begging, drinking, scoffing. Then feigning indifference. Then doing it all over again, all within the span of a page. It's nuts. Yeah, it's kind of nuts. There's a lot of emotion in this book. The next one comes from a conservative philosopher, so it will be a little bit more obvious than the rest of them. In the book, the monks say not completely what, or to be more precise, completely not what the very good monks actually say. I haven't talked to many monks, so I wouldn't know. The next person has listened to it on audiobook, and they're saying it's not the translation and it's not the reader. I'm pretty sure he's the same guy who read The Count of Monte Cristo, which has a similar prose style to this one, except that I enjoyed the novel. Think of something that's similar to The Count of Monte Cristo. I don't think that it has anything in common with this one, but I don't know. It's the tedious, repetitious prose and above all, the gosh-awful characters. Next one says, as for this being some kind of profound philosophical work, give me a break. There were no interesting and or unforeseen character developments, nor was there any particularly interesting message other than, wow, faith is complicated, and maybe the justice system is flawed. Earth-shattering stuff. 100% convinced that everyone who says they enjoyed this is faking it. In the immortal words of Marie Kondo, this does not spark joy. Unlike these reviews, I have to say, these people deserve so much compassion because they have put in so much time and effort to read and understand a long and dense text, and they didn't enjoy it at all. These are one-star reviews, you know? I hope that they find something that does spark joy. They deserve it. And here are some comments about the author written in Playboy. He was a prophet, a claptrap journalist, and a slapdash comedian. Yeah, think of someone who's a slapdash comedian. That's him, yeah. I admit that some of his scenes, some of his tremendous farcical roles are extraordinarily amusing, but his sensitive murderers and soulful prostitutes are not to be endured for one moment, by the reader anyway. I think this is the most obvious comment. Have you guessed yet? A book so large, it took me a day and a half to read the table of contents. Who reads the table of contents? This is a story about dull people who talk and weep a lot. I don't understand why this book is so important. I don't understand why is it so long. Take away all the nonsense about blah blah blah, and the plot wouldn't have changed. And yet, like, 200 pages are dedicated to this soggy diaper of a character. This is an amazing description. Take him out and I guarantee it wouldn't make a difference to the plot. I don't know what crime I committed, but my punishment was this book. I feel like an idiot. If you haven't guessed, this was about the Brothers Karamazov by Dostoevsky. And I love this book and these people didn't. But I can't help but think that this kind of inspired them to write these creative reviews because they were amazing. Like, yeah, The Brothers Karamazov is about a silly love story and the characters are all dull and there's even a soggy diaper of a character and it has so much in common with The Count of Monte Cristo in terms of style. They're like the same book, but one of them is enjoyable and the other isn't. That's fine. Let's move on to book number two. So there's this guy and he's in prison and then sidebar something about woods or maybe trees or like landscaping or is it grass and fields or maybe something else? I've lost my train of thought. And then he tries to break out and sidebar about a lot of writers you've never heard of and lots of inside jokes and reference probably no one at the time even got. And lots of weird social philosophizing that doesn't seem to have much to do with anything. Look, I kind of hate descriptions of nature and architecture and whatnot in most things. But when it comes to this author, he can make descriptions work for me. I don't know how. The next one is a review from the New York Times. The chief trouble we find with the writer is that when he intends to be philosophical or sentimental, he's simply mad. And his madness makes itself manifest in wordiness. He's a prosy madman. Many reviews are about the fact that this book is long. Like this one, this dude just won't shut up. Or this one, buddy, kindly, please, and I mean this with all the sincerity in the world, please shut the hell up. I get it. The next one says, melodrama, asides predictable plotting, cliche characters, and 1,200 pages long. This is what happens when you serialize books. Do not read this trash. I don't know, maybe I'm wrong, and I am, but how would you make it, let's say, a 600-page book? Which episodes would you take out of it? And I thought Dickens needed a good editor. This author says in 100 pages what could be said in 100 words. Really? This book literally put me off reading for 15 months. 15 months? That's such a long time. Why? I can't imagine how this person feels. The next one is from Atlantic Monthly. The writer attempts to prove that society itself is responsible for crimes it cannot prevent but only punish. Yeah, he kind of does. The next one is going to be super obvious, but let's see. War and Peace seemed 1,000 pages too short. This book unfortunately seemed 1,000 pages too long. Aww. Have you guessed it? And the last one is a bit too miserable for me. Yeah, it's Victor Hugo, Les Misérables. Yeah, it's one of my favorite books. I'd call The Hunchback of Notre Dame one of my favorite books as well, but I don't want to put more than one book by an author in this list. This is why I didn't pick all the other Dostoevsky novels for this. The next book was one of the most entertaining reads of my life, and I always thought that basically everyone enjoyed it. But apparently not. Apparently there are people who hated it. Let's hear them out. Favorite character, the hunting dog. Everyone else, a bunch of needy psychos. I don't think that psycho would be a right word to describe them, but yeah, the hunting dog was nice. The next review says that this book is a fictionalized representation of how rich people are completely capable of being dumbasses. I don't think that we needed any proof of that in this day and age, and the author himself was quite rich and quite capable of being a dumbass, but at least he knew that, and he tried to change it. This is regarded as one of the best books of all time. I got to chapter 6 and still hadn't met the title character. Yeah, there's something truly satisfying about finding the words from the title in the text itself, isn't it? You're like, bingo! Yeah, that's the title! Yay! And we're quite used to these epic and memorable introductions of characters in movies when you scream, oh, it's them! But in this case, it's different. You're not screaming, it's them. You're more like, is it that character from the title? That was it? Yeah, it can be underwhelming. I'll refer to the male character here as John, okay? I don't care about John. Stop talking about John. I get you like self-inserts, but dear God, I don't give a f*** about some self-obsessed, holier-than-thou, lord-turned-agriculturist, hypocritical hippie who was freaking obsessed and then abusive towards a teenager. Stop. Just stop. I guess this made things quite obvious. Have you guessed the book? The next review says, descriptions apart, the story itself was a problem. A book needs to have a great plot, or intricately etched believable characters, or a gripping backdrop, or a reasonable combination of all of these in order to hold a reader's attention. This book fails on all counts. I watched the adaptation before reading the novel, and I thought that we were supposed to side with this character, and the book was so different. Every chapter I read made me change my mind. I could understand and justify everyone's actions. This book made me more empathetic, and these characters aren't one-dimensional at all. You can like or dislike them, but you definitely get them. I referred to the female character as Jane. I used to say in my online dating profile that I was Jane, meaning I was deep and there were a lot of pages to my life story. After reading it, I decided to remove it. I found I disliked this character immensely, so much so that I never finished the book. Well, nothing changed. You are still deep, and there are a lot of pages to your life story, so this one seems to be accurate for all the books I mentioned today. Just because you can write a 1,000-page book doesn't mean you should. Yeah, it doesn't. And my favorite one, probably the one worse love story than Twilight, written about as well with flat characterization through repetition. Think of a love story. Is it Anna Karenina? No? What? What? Yeah, apparently this is the one worse love story than Twilight. Although I wouldn't think of it as a love story. I don't know. I'll talk more in depth about this book later, so stay tuned. But now let's move on to the next one. Reading this book is similar to ordering a Death by Dark Chocolate monstrosity of a cheesecake, but instead of bringing you a reasonable slice, the server brings you the whole cheesecake. I'll skip some details. Maybe magical realism is not my thing, and maybe my rating and review are similar to someone saying I didn't like that dessert, but then again, I don't like chocolate. That's nice. There are several suggestions that the author was high. And this is reasonable. This book, which was recommended to me by several very intelligent people, is like the unholy love child of Kafka and Dostoevsky. The plot is surreal and the characters mere mouthpieces. There was nothing in it I could care about. Oh. I mean, I guess I love the love child of Kafka and Dostoevsky. If the author wants me to think Satan should be avoided because he's achingly boring, he succeeded. Have you guessed it? This is all about The Master and Margarita by Mikhail Bulgakov. The story behind its publication is simply fascinating, but I don't think that right now I have the voice and you the attention span to process all this. The only things I'm going to mention is that the first draft was finished in 1929 and burnt in 1930, But as we know, manuscripts don't burn, so a few years later, Gogol was still haunted by this idea and kind of finished it and died. It was published in the late 60s with parts of it edited out, and Gogol didn't get to see the success of his masterpiece. I remember what inspired me to pick it up. It was Easter and I was at my grandma's, and I was watching this interview with a priest, and he was talking about Jesus and the Master of Margarita, and he described this book and said something like, "This makes people lose their faith." Naturally, I was very curious and I read it and I enjoyed it, but I can't say that it changed my beliefs. This is an unusual book and you can't really predict how someone would respond to it. Even people with similar tastes and a similar sense of humor disagree when it comes to this book. But even when you look at some illustrations inspired by it, you can see how interesting it is. It has all the elements of a bestseller and enough references and hidden meanings to satisfy most readers. It got me out of a reading slump, and it was one of the first Russian novels I read, and it inspired me to read Dostoevsky. There's this awesome scene where a character tries to get into a building and pretends to be Dostoevsky, and the lady says, "You're not Dostoevsky, Dostoevsky is dead." And he answers, "I protest, Dostoevsky is immortal." And I remember thinking, I really need to check him out. Love at first sight. This was a nice experiment for me. I found out that I love reading negative reviews to my favorite books, because even though they're negative, they're about something I love. There were a few books that didn't make it on this list just because I couldn't find any negative reviews of them. I don't know whether the lack of negative reviews suggests the fact that they're perfect or that nobody reads them. Maybe I'll make a part two of this sometime, not in the near future. But for now, thanks for watching. Bye!